And welcome everyone to today's Synergist webinar, Factory Process and Equipment Noise Engineering Controls. I'm Ed Rutkowski, Editor-in-Chief of the Synergist, the magazine of AIHA. I'd like to thank everyone for joining us today, and especially Kinetics Noise Control for sponsoring this webinar. I'm pleased to introduce today's speaker, John Sofra. As the market manager at Kinetics, John is responsible for the North American territory for the airflow attenuation, industrial, and environmental markets. He has been with Kinetics for 17 years. Previously, he spent 15 years holding various positions, including acoustics division manager for a national sheet metal duct and fitting manufacturer located in Columbus, Ohio. John's current team is made up of many sales and engineering professionals focused on airflow and acoustics. He has been involved with ASHRAE, ASTM, and the Air Movement and Control Association during his many years in industry. Now I'll turn the presentation over to John.
Thank you, Ed. I appreciate that. And it's great to be given the opportunity to spend an hour with everybody today. We're going to talk about 45 minutes to 50 minutes, and then we'll have about 10 minutes for questions. So please have questions towards the end, and we'll get started. So the title today is Factory Process and Equipment Noise Engineered Controls. And take a look at this. It's the same thing that Ed just covered, but take a look at my picture, and I'll come back to that later in the presentation. It's a quiz. So anyway, if we look at engineered controls and noise control for manufacturing facilities, we're going to hit three different things in this presentation that would come up in any noise control need, option, or requirement. And so we're going to look at the effects of noise on the human hearing, the cost of hearing conservation programs, and successful methods of noise control. At the end of the presentation, you'll be able to identify an 8-hour time-weighted average noise level set by OSHA that requires the implementation of a hearing conservation program. You'll be able to identify three main characteristics of effective noise control. Describe the advantages of implementing engineered controls in lieu of personal protection equipment, PPE, earplugs, or muffs. And then you'll identify different products that you can use in industry to control noise or engineered control noise. So just to get everybody in the mood of things, I know people out there, you interchange the word sound and noise. And I often say they are different, which they are. And so one way to get that across is, which are you most likely to say? Wow, that's a nice sound, or wow, that's a nice noise. Now, I always think of sound as being pleasant, nurturing, and calming, and noise to be disruptive, irritating, mind-blowing, and yes, dangerous. So we're going to talk noise today. And I love noise because it's fun to quiet it within acceptable limits. So if we look at this, not getting too in-depth, most of everything we go over today will be high level, but noise is just that. It's unwanted sound. And sound, we know, is a wave. It's propagating between a fluid or a solid. And when it propagates through a solid, what we call structure-borne sound, it's vibration. And you can see that in the man jackhammering there, where it's vibrating the hammer in himself and probably the grade that he's hammering into. But then in a fluid airborne sound, this disturbance travels as a long wave, and it's a fluctuation in sound pressure. As we show in this speaker here, we have sound energy exciting that speaker, and then as soon as it leaves the speaker, it becomes sound pressure as opposed to power, and that's what your ear senses. So your ear will sense sound pressure, and that's what we're going to talk about in this presentation today. When is noise control required? So we all are familiar with OSHA, and OSHA has a standard that requires employers to have a hearing conservation program in place if workers are exposed to a time-weighted average TWA noise level of 85 decibels or higher during an 8-hour work period. So we look at this a few different ways. First of all, we want to say, what is a DBA? Some of you may know, some of you may not. Okay, so a DBA is basically you take sound readings with a sound level meter at discrete frequencies like 63 hertz, 125 hertz, 250 hertz, all the way up to a center frequency of 8,000 hertz. And then you filter off of that and shape that frequency spectrum to better model what the ear senses as loudness, all right? Then you take all those numbers, you logarithmically combine them into one number, and that's your DBA level. So for those of you that may have a sound level meter at their factory and it just reads DBA, one level, an overall A-weighted level, well, in the background, it's doing all that filtering and measuring. So what is 85 DBA, though? What's the perception? So if you look at 65 DBA, normal conversation, that's us talking. Sometimes I know when I talk, I get a little louder. I might reach 85 DBA myself because I'm an excitable person, but 65 DBA is normal speech. When we get into the 90 to 95 DBA, that's when you start running into, over a period of time, you can run into hearing loss from sustained exposure. You might get tinnitus, ringing in the ears. If you really want to experiment, when you get to about 125 DBA, you start to experience pain. And then at 140, you'll quickly lose and have irreversible hearing damage. So that kind of gives you a feel for where 85 kind of falls in the scheme of things. Now, if you look at an overall sound level and we look at various pieces of equipment in a facility, whether part of a manufacturing process or actually supporting from the background manufacturing processes, we can look at a few items here. One would be like a pneumatic chipper. A pneumatic chipper is about 115 DBA. Generators, 105. Those are like diesel-driven backup generators, maybe a 2,500 kW or a 500 kW backup generator. And vacuum pumps, they run different frequency, maybe a little higher mid to high frequency, but that's 105 DBA. Hammer mills, 102 DBA. All the way down, just general ventilation exhaust fans can be as high as 101 DBA. Now look at all these as being about 3 feet away from the noise source of this piece of equipment, or 1 meter. Look at forklift traffic. Although that may not be continuous in all factories, in a distribution center it could be continuous, and you're already running at 87 DBA. Let alone the fact that if you have multiple noise sources, they actually combine with one another and make it even louder. If you want to feel for something that is very quiet, though, is you can look at it in the middle of a cornfield, and I put in the middle of nowhere because I used to put a state there, but I decided not to do that anymore because I love the state. But in the middle of a cornfield, in the middle of nowhere at 4 a.m., which is usually the quietest time outdoors, you can actually measure down to 25 dBA, which is extremely quiet. Once again, you want to get a feel for what this dBA means. What is 85 dBA? What is 90 dBA? And you're going to say, John, I see a lot of things in here like this slide. It says, what industries, what manufacturing industries are personnel exposed to noise levels above 90 dBA? And you're saying, John, what do I care? You said 85 dBA. Well, the 85 dBA is kind of a safety factor, you might want to call it. But 90 dBA is what we're seeing a lot in industry as very common. But let's get it down a little lower, which is 85 dBA. Some factories, even now that are starting up new facilities, are shooting for 80 dBA sound levels for an 8-hour workforce for time-weighted average. But you can see here, one of the things I really love about this industry is everybody makes noise, whether you're in lumber and wood, textiles, petroleum and coal, pulp and paper, chemicals, petrochem, food industry, furniture and fixtures. You can see there's a lot of things. So when you get down this exhaustive list here, I have et cetera at the bottom. Well, that gets just super long list. People say, who do you work with? Well, everybody makes noise. And that's the wonderful thing. But we need to harness that noise. A good rule of thumb, I think this is always good. When you feel the need to raise your voice in order to hear somebody 3 feet away, you're probably greater than 85 dBA. So if you're standing next to two of your coworkers and you're 3 feet away and you're having to do hand gestures to understand each other, you're probably pretty loud in that area, and you probably want to do a sound study to see what your time-weighted average really is. Was this just happening for a short period of time, which you're allowed to be exposed to higher levels in a short period of time, or was this a time-weighted average in excess of 85 dBA? When we look at types of noise control, so now we say, hey, there's noise. We get it, John, there's noise. But types of noise, there's engineered controls, and this is what is dear to my heart, is how do we eliminate or engineer out the noise? By using noise control products or replacing loud older equipment, what we find is older equipment tends to be louder, and new equipment tends to be more efficient and hence to be quieter. So sometimes you can just replace the piece of equipment. administrative, incorporate changes in the work procedures, such as reducing the duration somebody's exposed to these high noise levels. And what's really cool is that OSHA lists time periods someone, a worker or personnel, are allowed to be exposed to a level of noise. So maybe over an 85, maybe at 85 dBA, they're allowed 8 hours time-weighted average or below. But if it gets louder, they might be allowed to be exposed to it for an hour, say, without hearing protection. So you can do some administrative controls. And then there's PPE, personal protective equipment. Now, if you look at this list, I think we, you know, all know it would be great to engineer out this and make it go away and nobody has to wear earplugs. Administrative would be cool too, but now we got to police it and we got to schedule it. But then everybody goes for the PPE, the personal protection equipment, the muffs or the earplugs. That's always the first thing that people tend to go for. And so I just wanted to talk a little bit about that. When you look at foam earplugs, all right, we all know what the foam earplugs are. Periodically, though, removing the earplugs and using a radio or making a phone call or something, you know, that exposes your ear to high noise levels. And also just the fact that you might be using your hands in the process, a manufacturing process, when you take your hands off the process and you have to adjust or work with your earplugs, you have lost productivity at that point. You might even drop the earplug and have to clearly walk back to another area where they have the earplug so you can get a new pair. So some people also find foam earplugs uncomfortable, no matter how standard or custom fit, because they have custom fit earplugs. But foam earplugs can wiggle loose. Even the custom fit ones can wiggle loose if you start to perspire and things like that. So once again, you're having to adjust them, move them, lose productivity, drop them, maybe have to go get something else, plus expose your ears to these high sound levels. They don't have listen through technology. And I think this is one of the ones, you know, people talk about putting earplugs in and feeling claustrophobic. Well, putting earplugs in block important noises. So I said noise is bad, but sometimes noise is good, right? Because you can hear traffic. Maybe even if you're in a walk space, you never know what can happen next to you. A forklift coming by, maybe something happens. You want to hear that. Alarms, warning shouts. And people say, well, that's why we have flashing lights. And then you look and you think, you say, well, what if my back is to the flashing light? So, you know, it's great if you can get people out of earplugs and get into some engineered controls. And then you have an ear health risk. You know, everybody, when you take a break, you take your earplugs out, you're supposed to get a new pair of earplugs. That doesn't always happen. Or you take lunch break, you know, get a new pair of earplugs. That doesn't always happen. So sometimes earplugs go back in the ear after touching them with dirty hands. And so those are some of the things you need to be concerned with. Another thing that I thought was really interesting, and I normally didn't look at it this intensely before, but all your earplugs, what we have here is on the X-axis, we have earplugs to the left, different styles and muffs to the right, but all along that X-axis. And on the Y-axis, we have a noise reduction rating in decibels. And so we can see the laboratory data in the background, the yellow bars. And on the X-axis, the noise reduction rating, that's actually in decibels. And the interesting thing there is this is all tested in with respect to an ANC standard. So what's interesting, though, is what is reported is not really what you get. So now I have the red bars called field. And what's really interesting is the actual noise reduction you achieve in yellow. You might have a earplug that says it's good for NRR 33. Well, that's not 33 dB reduction, okay? What they do is they derate them. So when you do put them in your ear, your actual noise reduction is gonna be your noise reduction rating minus 7 dB divided by 2. So if it says NRR 33 dB, in all reality, when you install those in your ear and you insert them in your ear properly, you're only going to achieve a 13 dB reduction. So many of you know that already, all right? You know the ins and outs of this, but I just thought it's really interesting when you think about it. It's another thing where, you know, you may not be getting what you think you're getting. And it's because all earplugs fit in ears differently, and there's only usually one or two styles of earplugs available. Now we look at a cost of hearing conservation program. So we, you know, one thing that OSHA has stated and published, and also independent studies have shown, and the value can vary, but on average, hearing conservation programs mandated by OSHA can cost an employer about $350 per worker per year. All right. And you say, well, I only have 10 workers. So we look in this chart here, that's only $3,500 a year. That's not a lot to have a hearing conservation program. But what if you have 100 workers? Now you're $35,000 a year against your operating, you know, it'll reduce your operating gross profit and affect that. Let's look at 500. There's almost $200,000 a year if you have areas where you have many workers in an area where they need to wear earplugs. There's a noise control myth out there, and a lot of people say engineered controls are expensive. So engineered controls are just that. Remember, we're going to quiet down a noisy piece of equipment. We might apply some noise control designs or technologies to quiet that down. And people say, well, that's so expensive. And then you have to sit there and think, though, and you say, compared to what? When you start adding in the dollars of paying disability claims for noise-induced hearing loss and tinnitus and paying for the elements of an effective hearing conservation program, and then you look at the reduced safety risk and, you know, the situational awareness, when you factor all that in, maybe a one-time cost for an engineering control is not a bad thing. Whereas everything below here, like disability claims and paying for the elements of an effective hearing conservation program, the great thing with those, although it's not so great, but some people could say, is they continue to cost you year over year over year, where the engineering controls is a one-shot deal. It's done. Let's move on. Everybody's out of hearing protection. So if we look at the return on investment using engineering controls, studies show a 10-to-1 return on investment on dollars spent on engineered controls compared to paying disability claims. Many engineering control products exhibit usually a return on investment of 2 to 4 years versus hearing conservation costs, which continue, and I just mentioned this, they love to keep giving year over year or costing year over year over year. So once again, if you can engineer out the noise, get people out of hearing protection, keep them safer, that's always the way to go. Now, that's the beginning, okay? That's hearing, why it's important, what people normally go to. You have the changes, you have engineered controls, administrative controls, and PPE. People tend to go for PPE often. And maybe that's not the best way to start. But if you look at this picture here, and I wanted you to look at my picture in the beginning, this picture on this person here is actually my emoji. So everybody laugh, enjoy themselves, but that's what that is. Now, what we're going to talk about is learning the ABCs of acoustics. You're going to look at absorbers, you're going to look at barriers, and you're going to look at a composite, which is actually a combination of absorbers and barriers. And we're going to look at some different things, and we're going to talk, it's more of a show and tell, to give you the feel for what might be able to be done. A lot of people say, oh, we have this noise here, there's too much going on in the area, we can't enclose anything, so there's nothing we can do. But maybe they only need 6 to 10 dBA reduction. So what I'll do in the first thing here is show you there is something you can do. Let me advance this. Okay. So we're going to look at sound absorption. And, you know, the best thing to do with a noise source is when the noise is emanating sound, it's great if you can get real close to that noise source and either enclose it or put a block, something to block the noise between you and it. And that's the best thing to do, but you can't always do that in a factory if there's a lot of processes going on and a lot of movement and a lot of flow in the area. You don't want to put in noise control but affect productivity of your flow process of your product. So if you only need noise reduction of say 10 dBA or less, sometimes you can just use sound absorption, where we apply sound absorption on the walls and the ceiling of the space of the area that we're concerned with. So we look at the walls, the ceiling, the floors, what they're made of. Do they already have absorption associated with them? The length, width, and height of the space. And then we have to look at the lighting and the sprinklers and other obstructions. You know, we want to make sure we don't block certain things, especially sprinklers and lighting. So a better way to show you this is on the next screen, is when you look at this and you look at sound absorption, you see the person's ear on the left side, the person's receivers on the left side, and the noise source is on the same side as the receiver. The sound actually propagates to the right. It goes through a sound-absorbing media. When that goes through the sound-absorbing media, some of that sound energy is just that. It dissipates as heat. It is absorbed into the open cell sound-absorbing media. And then some of that sound will actually reflect back from the solid surface, say a cinder block wall that the absorptive media is on. And it'll reduce the noise even more. So it kind of goes through the absorption twice. And that'll reduce that reverberant noise. And I always think of this as when I was a kid, we had hard floors, concrete walls, you know, wood floors, concrete plaster walls and ceiling. And we had throw rugs in there and couches, and we had blinds on the windows and curtains, and everything was fine when you're in that room. But when my father decided he wants to paint that room, he would take everything out. And I remember as a little kid, that room would become really echoey, and it was hard to understand each other because it was what we call a live or an active room, and there was a lot of reflection, a very reverberant room. But then when he got done and he put the throw rug back in, the couch, the blinds, the curtains, everything that had sound absorption, it would deaden that reverberation down. And now we could understand and hear each other again. So it's just like that. And that's what we would do in a factory space. One item that you could use as an absorber is a quilt. Maybe you're looking at an automotive garage. How many times have we gone in and we've heard the air wrenches and stuff, and maybe a tire center? And very noisy, but it's over the whole area, you know, very reverberant concrete walls, ceiling, or concrete walls and floor. And then environmental control booths, building material wraps, machine housings. There's a lot of things you can line with these quilted absorbers. And really the quilt, the thicker the better. Usually there's a 1, a 2-inch, or even a 4-inch nominal thickness before you quilt it of fiberglass with a protective facing on it. And this is an excellent example here. This is an area where there was too much equipment in that area, just way too much equipment to be able to enclose anything. But they only needed about 8 dBA reduction. And so what they were able to do in this place is an important thing with noise control that I have to say right here, in order for anybody to do an effective noise control solution, best thing to do is get representatives of different parts of your facility. So in this case, we would want the supervisor or the foreman of the area. We would want some of the maintenance representatives in this. We would want the safety engineer involved, maybe the plant manager. We want people involved in this area and one of the employees working in this area, working on the line. We'd want them involved because the best thing to do is sit back and watch the flow. Watch what's happening in the area before you just put up a solution, because everybody's input's important so we don't interfere with the productivity of the space. What we did here, or what is done here, this is done by many, but what is done here, it's a high bay area, congested process. So you can see the quilts are run horizontally in 4 tiers. The quilt is very light. It's just like pillowy light. And what we're doing is we're adding absorption. These are the curtains, these are the drapes, this is the couch, the absorption that we're adding to this hard space. And what was really interesting is a lot of these areas, you'll look up at the steel, the trusses and the steel ceiling space, and you'll see it's insulated for thermal. Well, that insulation is a great absorber as well. So as you model the reverberations in the space, you can determine how much noise control you need or how much coverage on these walls you need. Stayed out, got the noise reduction they need just due to controlling the reverberant energy. I keep hitting the page down and I have to hit this other thing. Oh, there we go. Thank you. Another way is that for hanging baffles, you know, maybe warehouses, conveyor facilities, you know, some conveyor facilities, you think of all these distribution centers, many of us during the last year ordered lots of things from one particular distribution company. And I'll admit, when you go into their facilities, I would imagine with all the conveyors, it's probably a little noisy, but I'm not sure. But you can use hanging baffles. And these hanging baffles can be anywhere from 2 foot tall by 4 foot wide, and they're 2-inch thick, or they can be 4 foot tall by 8 foot wide. And once again, you want to manage how much absorption you put in the space. They can also come with an FDA approved facing, so for the food and drug industry. And we have a good example here of such an application. This is at a candy factory. Now, at a candy factory, it's really kind of interesting, okay? Picture candies that look like Chiclets, for those of you that know what Chiclets look like. And picture earplugs in your ears, even if they have the little lanyard on them. So if they fall out of your ear, they're not supposed to fall into the process. But let's say the lanyard breaks and they fall into the process, and somebody opens a box of Chiclet kind of candy looks, and they find an earplug in there. That's not good, right? So this company was just hovering. They were like 88 dBA, and they needed to get below 85 they wanted. So they didn't need much. They were at 90 dBA, and they didn't need much. So what they did was they went ahead and they put 4 foot tall by 8 foot long hanging baffles, just like the previous page that we had talked about. And those hanging baffles were spaced just right to not interfere with the sprinkler systems, not interfere with the lighting. Everybody was able to remove their hearing, their PPE, no earplugs anymore. And so, it was also an FDA approved facing, which was nice. And so able to meet their needs on that. Another absorption panel would be one where they take insulation and they wrap it in Class A rated facing. And those can be either in 1, 2, or 4 inch thick. And of course, the thicker, the more absorption you have. And those can be used in a lot of places. You see on the left, that certain type of panel can be used at a distribution center where they slide it in to the trusses just to add absorption in the space. Doesn't always matter where you put the sound absorption. What's more important is that you're adding it to the space. Another part is you can see at the bottom are some pump rooms and some generator rooms where they lined it with that absorptive material. When you get into some areas like wastewater treatment plants, indoor, outdoor equipment yards, shipping containers, things where you want maybe something more rigid, you can get an absorption panel 2 inch or 4 inch thick, but it's all rigid. It's metal, either aluminum, stainless, or galvanized, and it's perforated metal with insulation behind it. So you can use that as well. And that shows you here on the right a dynamometer test cell, and on the left is a hydro power plant where there's pumps and that making a lot of noise. Sound blocking is the next thing. So we looked at absorption only if you need about 10 dBA or less in noise reduction. But what if you need more? What if you need like 18 dBA or 45 dBA noise reduction? Now you got to incorporate mass. Which is going to block. So the higher the mass, it's the mass law is what it's all about. And the higher the mass, the more blocking capabilities of noise you'll have. And you can get a significant amount of noise reduction. But now when you start to do things, you're probably not backing away from the noise source. You're probably attacking the noise source. You're coming very close with equipment enclosures around noise sources that radiate noise. Now you have to look at different things. You have to look at routine access for just routine maintenance or catastrophic maintenance. You know, if there's a catastrophic event and you need to pull a motor and replace it. Visual access, you want ports, process. You want to be able to see personnel if they're in there or they can see out. You want to look at proper ventilation because you don't want to enclose a hot process or piece of equipment, have it overheat. So we don't want that to happen. So let's go to the next. So some sound energy is reflected when you have sound blocking. So some sound energy reflects back at you, and usually the noise source is within, encapsulated within the noise control or the enclosure. And then you have the person, the receiver on the outside. And these can typically come, it's all gonna vary with the mass, the pound per cubic, or I'm sorry, pound per square foot. The higher the pound per square foot mass, the better blocking capabilities you'll have. One option is a flexible barrier. You can use it above drop ceiling. Say you have a break room or a control room in the middle of a facility and the facility is making a lot of noise and you have these beautiful sand-filled cinder block walls and these acoustic windows and doors, but you're still getting noise breaking in. You've attenuated the ventilation system, but you're still getting noise in. Sometimes in that drop ceiling, you might want to add mass, and this is a great product for that. Right behind those drop ceiling tiles, add mass, and that'll control a lot of the noise breaking into your space. If you have any kind of chutes or like chutes in a factory where you're putting product or maybe metal shavings in and there's making a lot of noise as the product goes through the duct or the piping, you can wrap it with this massive product. Another way is a distribution warehouse. I know I brought it up before, but here's a conveyor system over top of everybody. And it's very interesting. You hear all those rollers and all those motors and everything. And one way you can control that, the noise coming straight down, is to line it with this mass loaded vinyl. And then anywhere there was a motor, they were able to drop the vinyl, get into the roller motors and fix or maintain that. Now we look at something with sound absorption and sound blocking. So we looked at absorption, you need about 10 dBA or less noise control. We looked at when you need more, like 18 to 45 dBA, we looked at just blocking. But the best of both worlds is just that, combining the two into one and calling it a composite. So we want to look at absorption and blocking together. You can get a significant amount of noise with this control. And it's really great because you get absorption first, where it breaks up some of that and absorbs some of that sound energy before it can even impinge upon the mass, and the mass is going to block whatever's left. And that's just the best of both worlds. Once again, you want to look at the ventilation, you want to look at visual access. You got to start you're controlling the noise right at the source. And that's what we have here. So basically, you have sound source on the left. It penetrates through and is absorbed in the absorbent material. Some of that sound gets reflected back, which goes through the absorbent material again. Whatever's left then has to break through or try to pass through or transmit through the mass, and then whatever's left is the reduced noise that the receiver will hear. Some of the products in a soft type product that we would say flexible product would be right here, where you can see in the lower right corner, there's two layers of fiberglass sandwiching one layer of a mass loaded vinyl. And that mass loaded vinyl can be either 1 pound or 2 pound per square foot. And so the more mass, the more blocking. This one is great because noise on one side gets absorbed by the fiberglass media. Then it has to break through the mass loaded vinyl. And then before it can reach the receiver, it has to go through some more absorptive material. So it's just a great product, very economical, cost effective, biggest ability to block noise for the price. Now, noise control doesn't have to be complicated either. Okay, sometimes people think of, oh my God, engineered controls, this is a huge expensive project. Well, let's show you an example here. This is a crosscut saw, and this was very interesting. In the background of the picture on the right, it's very, very interesting, because when you'd walk into this space, this was a crosscut saw and they were cutting aluminum extrusions. And when you'd walk in from the angle, you see the picture before the noise control curtains were up, everybody would cringe. You could see their backs were to this process way in the background. And every time that would come down and cut, they would just flinch. And so even with earplugs, they would just flinch in some cases. So instead of putting earplugs in, where some people had earplugs, some people didn't, they were able to put in this simple three-sided. You see two sides here, but there's a backside not shown in a roof. So in this case, this was mass-loaded composite product, barrier and quilt, so it absorbs and blocks. And the only person that needed to wear muffs or earplugs was the operator. The rest of the people could get out of earplugs altogether. This is interesting too, quilted barrier composite. The interesting thing here is that this is a cutting process, a die cutting process. And what was great and why these mass loaded vinyl or composite curtains are so great is they can fit a process. So in this case, there were openings on the right. You see these little rectangular gray is where the curtains are, and there were openings there. And so we were able to put mass-loaded vinyl composite curtains in front of it to block the noise when it was operating. But at times, they needed to remove those, so they were easily removable. The safety fence that you see here, it was already existing. So they were able to, as this is an output here, there was a lot of noise coming out in this direction. They were able to line the inside of that safety fence with the composite quilt and barrier and attach it via lifting, via grommets that are already factory installed in the panels, the curtain panels, with nylon zip ties to the fence. And you can also use wire zip ties, but it worked out really good. So the point is they're very forgiving and they can be cut to size to fit your process to minimize costs of solution. Another one is the great thing with these composite quilts is they can fit just about anything, all right, because they can be made to fit. So this is an extrusion. Actually, this is a debridging system, aluminum system, and there was a conveyor there. There was an area here on the upper right which is actually strip curtains where they could reach in and make sure there's no jams or anything. The frame system was made to attach to their conveyor system, and they were able to go from 100 dBA down to 85 dBA in the space. This is an example of, pieces of equipment. You know, this particular one was for radiator fin presses, little fins for radiators, and you heard a lot of that ka-chunk, 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 and there was seven of these or eight of these in the facility. One way to do it is just put a big corral around all eight, but instead this owner wanted to actually isolate each and custom fit each piece of equipment, so that's what was done there. Here's at a wire braiding process. This is very interesting. We talked about the curtains. At the top here, the interesting thing is at the top is we have the, it's an open top, and we actually used the hanging baffles. And that was the coolest thing. We used the hanging baffles, and they were able to get the lights and the sprinklers, no interference there. They were able to control the noise breaking out the sides. They had viewports that they could see through mass-loaded vinyl clear view windows, and it worked out really good. So once again, that was not just composite product, but it was a composite solution using multiple products. They were able to reduce that by 15 dBA. Now, something to remember, too, you say 15 dBA, and that doesn't sound like a lot, but because it's logarithmic, remember, a 10 dBA reduction in sound is going to be perceived by the average person as sounding half as loud. So if you're 100 dBA and you knock it down to 90 dBA, somebody's going to say, wow, that sounds half as loud. So it doesn't take but 10 dBA to make a huge difference. In factories, a lot of times factories are being repurposed or things are being moved. There may be an opening at a factory where you want to control noise from a loud side of the factory to a quiet side, maybe manufacturing to shipping and receiving or something. So you can use these composite curtains to retrofit in, as you see in the lower right, double tracks where you can part these curtains and get through any time and still see through them. Or there's also a version called strip curtains, which many of you know as freezer curtains, but they have a certain mass to them and they can block noise from one part of the factory to another as well. Sometimes if you look here on the right, there's people coming in the right of the picture, there's a door and they're walking up to the stairs. Well, behind here was some compressors and a fan. And what would happen is as you're walking through here and you didn't require any hearing protection, every now and then those would turn on and they'd scare the heck out of you. And it's probably not a good idea to take your first step and be startled up those stairs. So they blocked off this area and made it into a retrofitted mechanical room. And they can bipart these curtains one behind another on a trolley track. And they have mass and absorption. And they're very easy to install. A lot of this product, general maintenance can install these. So that's the nice thing. And then in some cases, you want something really elaborate where it's not as simple. And this was a 16-foot tall system for a plywood tongue and groove manufacturing process. And that has strip curtains, it has the 2 pound per square foot composite quilt and vinyl, and it even has a rigid noise block panel roof, which we'll talk about next. You might have an area where you want to put an office within a space. So it's very easy to put in a curtain office, as you see here, within these manufacturing processes. You can also have mobile. So maybe you have a process that moves around the factory. Maybe they're welding, maybe they're cutting, maybe they're doing something that's gonna move around a shop that does a lot of custom work. Well, you can have these on rollers and move them around, link many of them together and always have a changing noise control solution. Now, we talked about some soft goods, but you can look at a composite rigid panel. And that's where you look here. And on the outside, you might have a 16-gauge solid galvanized sheet steel, so quite massive. The panel's about 4 inches thick. You have a perforated metal on the inside, inside skin that you can kind of see through this cut. And then you have insulation. I saw some people wrote mineral wool on here. There's some other rock wool. There's some fiberglass, a lot of different wicking products if you were to use them outside and they get exposed. So there's a lot of good products that we use or that can be used in these panels. And these are when you really need that heavy-duty noise control, more like that 45 dBA, that 35 dBA noise reduction. You can see here a stamping press, and you can see where all the panels, those double-wall steel panels, and then you have a biparting door here to get into the process. You might have a CNC enclosure. That's what this one here is. Or you have a test facility inside right in the middle of your plant, and people are working in the test facility, and it's making a lot of noise in there. So they want to look and make a control room out of these double wall steel panels. You might have a facility here up in a mezzanine. They want a lot of access. They want a lot of views. So they have acoustic windows as well as those rigid panels. Maybe at a petrochem plant, they have an exhaust blower, a lot of radiant noise off that exhaust blower. So not just in the facility do we need to be 85 dBA, but on the premise of this facility, we need to be 85 dBA. Maybe at a manufacturing facility where they're testing, and it's not that they want to keep the noise from emanating out, they want to keep noise from going in because they're actually testing the mechanical electric seats in trucks. Where everyone that goes by, these guillotine doors come up, it goes in there and it's tested for sound to make sure it's quiet enough. The next thing and the last thing is ventilation silencing. And I think we're doing really well. We got about 5 minutes. And so there's a lot of exhaust fans, a lot of general exhaust fans, a lot of makeup air, and we want to quiet things down, such as dust collectors, particulate conveyings, or just cooling equipment or personnel. And the noise is generated by fans. I love fans so much because they make a lot of noise. Somebody said they were going to start making quieter fans. I wasn't happy. But the thing is that fans make noise because the blades, as they spin, they impart upon the air molecules. And then there's also sometimes bad flow conditions. And it makes a lot of noise. Once again, quieter fans, sometimes that can be considered. But sometimes that's only going to get you maybe 5 or 10 dBA. You might need 30. dBA noise reduction. So you start looking at silencers, ventilation silencers, and acoustic louvers, and they can be tuned to give you the right amount of noise control while balancing available, you know, making sure the back pressure isn't too much, because we want to make sure we balance the airflow against the available external static supplied by the fan, say. And you can look at different shapes here. You can look at your basic rectangular silencers to the left, your basic circular silencers in the middle with a sound absorbing a bullet in it, and then also your acoustic louvers. How does a silencer work? If we look in the upper right, noise comes in from the left. These baffles that you see in here, they're called absorptive acoustic media. They're actually sound baffles. So the air speeds up and flows between them. The baffles have a perforated face and insulation behind them, so some of that sound energy penetrates the perforated metal, and some of that energy gets reduced within the baffles. And then downstream, we have a static regain tail, so we can slowly expand that air, get some of that static regain energy back, and then fill the downstream path of air. And so from upstream to the left to downstream to the right, there's a noise reduction. Different, similar, but different than the muffler on your vehicle. And here's just general exhaust off a factory. It's very interesting because sometimes you'll see a factory and there'll be general exhaust fans, and there might be 30 of them up on the roof. Well, that's all fine and dandy, but the neighbors, because industrial and residential are moving closer now, they're kind of skipping commercial properties, and they're moving closer, so they can make a lot of tonal noise issues for the environment and for the, now we get into environmental noise control and noise ordinances. So you can actually design and mount these silencers to control that noise. And here's just a general centrifugal fan. You can see the intake circular silencer and a discharge rectangular silencer moving upward. This is at a, they're actually making pet food, and you go here and it smells like dog food for miles. But it's very interesting. Up on the roof, they had a lot of these exhaust. It was clean air by that point, but it had odor to it, such as smelled like dog food. But then we put our, you know, circular silencers, and there were numerous units on the roof. And then this is just a combination, which is really interesting, and it's second to the last slide. It shows some of those double wall panels blocking the radiant noise off the dust collection fan, and then the upblast silencer to control the fan noise within the blades imparting upon the air molecules. And one thing that's very interesting for anybody that may have called in from out west, west of the Mississippi at least, a lot of the wastewater treatment plants have pump rooms, and they all have single blade weather louvers on them, and that's been great. But now, not just like I said before, being in a factory, you might need 85 dBA. On many of these sites, you need 85 dBA or less on the site. And so they're replacing a lot of those with acoustic louvers, which is very interesting, and just literally straight swap, plug and play, making sure the back pressure balances properly. So with that completes today's presentation. I went 46 minutes, but I think it was 45 because I started a minute late. So there were a lot of slides. I'm sure there's a lot of questions. And at this point, I'll turn it over to Ed.
Thanks, John. Yes, we do have a lot of questions, so I'll get right to it. We've got about a little less than 15 minutes. If we don't get to your question, I apologize in advance, but we will provide all of them to John and Kinetics so they can reach out to you individually later. So the first question is from Timothy, and he is asking, his question rolled in around slide 20, and he's asking about the product that was pictured on that slide, I believe. I think it was the quilted absorber. And he asks, are there any fire code concerns with curtains such as those?
It broke out. Which concern? Are there any what concerns?
Any fire code concerns with those curtains?
Oh, I see. Okay, yeah, fires were. No, there isn't. They're Class A rated. They're all independently tested, and they carry a Class A rating, which is basically the rating you would need for your processes, your factories. It's also used in elementary schools and government facilities. So the Class A rating is what you would need, and they expose that. Yeah, they have that exhibited.
Okay, great. Next question is from Gustavo, and he asks, how do you analyze the difficulty that companies have to attenuate and control the noise generated by equipment that emits noise at low frequencies?
That's a great question, and it's an awesome question because the key is that it's a lot harder to attenuate noise at low frequency. And the one thing I want to let you know is low frequency noise has very long wavelengths, which means over a long distance, like at 63 hertz, I think the wavelength is 18 feet, one wavelength. There's a lot of energy in that one wavelength. And it also takes a lot more energy in the low frequency bands for it to be even a problem to your ear. So because you have to pump all that energy in there to it to be even be a problem, and now you got to control it, now you have to do things differently, such as you need a lot more mass. Sometimes it's so loud in the low-frequency noise bands that when I showed you about enclosing something in a metal double-wall enclosure, sometimes you need to put it an enclosure, an air gap, and then another enclosure, so an enclosure within an enclosure for those really extreme low-frequency 63 hertz, 125, 31.5 hertz. Those are very critical, and the key there is more mass when it comes to a product. Then for solution, another one, if you have very low frequency, let's say a fan or something with an airstream is creating very low frequency noise, now you're going to want a silencer, but not a silencer like that rectangular one I showed you that might be 3 or 5 feet long. You might need a silencer 10 to 12 feet long and that the air passes through. And then you have to balance that back pressure, and then you have to find out where you have room for it. So the best thing to say is there's definite ways to solve that. The key thing is that the lower the noise frequency issue, Typically, the larger the noise control solution, the more massive and hence more expensive, but it can all be done.
Okay. Josh has a question. I believe he was talking about the product that was shown on slide 39. It was, I believe, a curtain with windows, and he asked, to clarify, those windows were clear mass-loaded vinyl, so you can see through them plus get attenuation?
That is correct, and that's another great question. Thank you. So those windows are just mass-loaded vinyl. So you'll see the quilt that the windows were in. That was mass-loaded vinyl sandwiched between two layers of quilt. But, of course, you can't see through that, so we put the clear view windows in there. So if that mass-loaded vinyl in the quilt was 1 pound per square foot, those windows would be mass-loaded clear vinyl of 1 or 2 pounds per square foot. So, yeah, they offer noise control, not just viewing, but also noise control. And the great thing is in technology over the years is those kind of windows used to yellow and things over the years. But about, 12 to 15 years ago, they really did a good job where those windows stay nice, crystal clear over time.
Okay, thanks, John. Spencer has a question and a comment. He says, what does Kinetic suggest regarding scoping, identification, and selection of specific products? Acoustical engineers are great at providing studies, but do not often identify specific products.
That's a very good question, too. So we love our acoustical consulting friends. They're very smart. We work with them on a daily basis. Many times their job is to come in and determine if you have a noise problem, no doubt about it, and they do a beautiful job of that. But then sometimes, and in many cases, and this is the fun thing about factory noise, manufacturing noise, is that things are very custom sometimes or different, you know. So what usually happens here is that somebody will contact a noise control manufacturer's representative. And then those representatives, if they're in industry, industrial focus, they'll know to come in, walk the site, and go back to where I had mentioned where you gather your teams from the factory, you know, people within the space, people that are working there, maintenance employees. And then they come in and they look at your process. Then they look and say, well, okay, this is the kind of noise control you need. This is the product we'll use. This is how much DBA noise control you need. And these are the limitations of the site. And what are your ideas, Mr. Customer? Because you know the flow of the process and you've already been thinking about this. We know you have. And then we put a solution together. And the key is to use as much standard product to a non-standard solution and then clean up the corners with something non-standard. In other words, it's always about getting maximum noise control, not interfering with the manufacturing process, but also staying within budget or being most economical. And those are always the important things. And so acoustical consultants will determine where you have a noise problem. You may have a huge facility, but you only have a one hotspot area that you need to be concerned with. That's great. Then usually they'll recommend a manufacturer or a manufacturer's rep who specializes in this to actually come up with the solution if the acoustical consultant hasn't already designed something. Hope that helps.
Okay, thanks, John. The next question is from Ashton, and he asks, what type of sound barrier or absorption do you need to run an octave band analysis to determine the frequency of attenuation?
Let me think of this. Did he say in the beginning, was he looking for, I'm not sure that I'm understanding it correctly, but what we do, if this answers it correctly, is every noise source gives off a different sound spectrum. So you might have a noise source. Let's say you have two noise sources. One has predominantly high noise levels, like at 1,000 hertz to 8,000 hertz. And the other noise source has mostly low frequency noise, like 63 hertz to 500 hertz. On a sound level meter, they might both read that they're operating at 100 dBA. but they both will need different noise control because one's low frequency noise and one has a high frequency noise problem. Now, what typically is done is to look at that, if there's no factory data on the equipment that might have been purchased from an equipment manufacturer, but it's real life world noise, then just a DBA sound level meter won't be able to tell you. They'll tell you the overall DBA, but it won't tell you what frequencies are predominant and hence drive you into the proper noise control. So you'll need a sound level meter that at least reads 63 hertz, 125 hertz, 250, 500, 1,000, 2,000, 4,000, and 8,000 hertz discrete center frequencies. And if you can get that, that's enough to at least tell you how to tackle the noise issue. So I don't know if that answers it, but that's how I understood it.
Okay, thanks, John. We've got a couple of questions here about cleaning. Patrick asks, how do you clean the curtains?
Well, one way you can use it, and I'll just use the name out there because it's almost like saying Xerox, like every copier is a Xerox, even though it might be a Toshiba or a Samsung or something. So you can use a product, an all-purpose cleaner, like a Simple Green. Okay, that's one way. You can steam clean them. The thing you don't want to do is power wash them. And I'll tell you a quick story. 50-foot long wall in a factory with this quilt on it, beautiful, pillowy, looks soft quilt to reduce the reverberant noise. And somebody was told by the owner to go out and power wash this. Now, I think when you look at it, you'd power wash and say, man, I can't get too close or I'll cut this up. I'll just power wash it real soft with a real fine mist. Well, they got 25 feet down the wall and they found out that they were power washing it too close and shredded it all. So you don't want to power wash it, but steam cleaning and wipe down with a general purpose cleaner works well.
Okay, and the next question too, Peter was asking about preferred methods or products for cleaning not only the quilted acoustical panels, but the perforated or porous panels. Do you have any recommendations there?
Yeah, the perforated or porous panels, we had only one in this item here, which was a metal perforated panel, which was an absorptive panel. And once again, that's normally just a wipe down or vacuum, because sometimes they might collect dust, and sometimes people will just vacuum. They're also often powder coated finish, so they look really nice. So you can pretty much just wipe them down with an all-purpose cleaner, and or vacuum the dust if there any dust collects. That's about it.
Okay. Elon asks, do ventilation silencers throw off the air balance of a ventilation system?
You know what? If they sure do, and that's why it's very, very important to make sure you tune them properly to so that doesn't happen, so it doesn't create a negative effect. So the idea with a ventilation system is you want to get the air where you want it, when you want it, especially cooling and spot cooling air. And so usually a system is an air system uses a prime mover or a fan to operate and move that air in the system. Systems are usually designed to say, okay, this fan will produce a certain amount of static pressure on the discharge, static pressure on the intake, coming out with a total pressure, total static pressure. But a lot of times it'll be sized for external static pressure, like maybe there's some dampers or louvers or something that are going to eat up some energy. So it'll be sized with a little extra energy. So one thing you want to look at when you look at a fan, dust collector, you don't want to put too much choke down the dust collection or it's not going to convey, general ventilation. You want to look at the fan that's operating the process. You want to look for what's called an external static pressure that's available. And then that's the pressure that's above and beyond your design pressure to operate your system that you can then size your silencer and make sure it's staying within that and only eating up that extra pressure. And so then when you operate the system, it eats up the extra pressure, but you're still operating at the pressure that was designed for.
Okay, thanks, John. And unfortunately, that's all the time we have for today. There are a lot of questions I wasn't able to get to. I apologize for that. John did provide his contact information in the chat, so you can reach out to him directly. And alternatively, we will provide all these questions to John and Kinetics at a later time, and they can reach out to you at a later date. My thanks to John Sofra for his presentation, to Kinetics Noise Control for sponsoring today's webinar, and to all of our participants. Please join us again on April 20th as Velocity, EHS, and HumanTech present a product demo, how smart companies build world-class ergonomics processes, and on May 10th for SKC's webinar on measuring occupational noise. Thanks and have a great day.
Thanks, folks.
Thank you, everyone. This actually concludes today's webcast. Thank you all for attending. The recording will be available at aiha.webvent.tv. We will send all registrants an email tomorrow with this link, and please visit our event calendar to sign up for future webcasts.